Hey, hello everyone. Thank you guys for attending this presentation. Today I am presenting joint work with my good friend and co-author Seth Benzel on simulating the global and macroeconomic impact of transformative AI. To preface this presentation, we view this white paper and the related working paper that we are about to present as part of a larger project on using state-of-the-art macroeconomic modeling to investigate the economic impact and potential policy responses of advanced AI technologies. So a lot of this agenda is under progress, and we welcome any collaboration and or support. Before talking about our findings, I'd first like to talk a little bit about what we define as transformative AI. Our definition, preferred definition, is that transformative AI is AI technologies that have the capacity to replace a plurality, or potentially, eventually, even a majority of tasks currently being done by humans, by labor. Now, this has not happened yet. You can look at the BLS data. US labor share has declined in the past 30 or 40 years, but it hasn't really changed very dramatically. On the other hand, we have seen technological advancements. In particular, I think we're talking about large language models that have arisen in the past several years that could plausibly one day become transformative. And if you think about maybe a close analogy to the emergence of these technologies, something like the Industrial Revolution, I think it's clear, at least to me, that a technology that replaces labor with capital on a massive scale would have significant implications on labor income, on inequality, welfare, as well as the distribution of global economic power. And what we're doing is building a simulation tool drawing from state-of-the-art macroeconomic modeling to understand these implications, as well as evaluate potential fiscal policy responses to address potential transformative AI scenarios. And macroeconomic policy responses are ultimately a macroeconomic question. And a natural question, follow-up question would be, what is the right kind of model to answer such questions? Well, we think that it needs to be global, in that it would allow these technologies to have different economic impacts, different countries. Different countries have different capital intensivities, have different composition of labor forces, and there's no reason to believe that transformative technologies would affect these countries in the same way. It would also be a general equilibrium model. We believe that household behavior influences macro outcomes. We live in a very connected world, and we want a model where the decision of each consumer is important to macro decisions, and vice versa. We think that the US cares about Chinese consumer behavior, cares about investments and savings, and the Chinese care about what US consumers do, and the model should be able to incorporate that. It should also have significant heterogeneity in skill, education, age. Different types of workers, different generations of workers are likely affected by transformative AI in different ways. A worker who is on the boundary of retirement is not going to be affected the same way as someone who is just coming to labor force. Similarly, someone who does very routine work, someone who does manual labor, is likely going to be affected very differently from someone doing more traditional white-collar work, or doing a creative role, or a very kind of high-skill occupation. So the model should incorporate that as well. Of course, should also be precisely calibrated. And we like to think that we have a tool that incorporates all of these features. Given time constraints, I will provide a very high-level overview of the model. If you read our BER working paper, as well as our Stanford Digital Economy Lab white paper, they go into significantly more detail. What we do is we split the world in 17 regions, the US, Western Europe, China, India, Russia, et cetera, et cetera. And these regions incorporate about 98% of world output and about 99% of global population, comprise about 150 countries on all the continents. And in each of these assumed regions, we have individuals who comprise three types of skills, high skill, middle skill, low skill, which we calibrate to income. Each type of individual will work, consume, and invest. They are assumed to be perfect for several macro variables. They enter a labor force. They work. They retire at a region-specific age. They receive pensions. They experience idiosyncratic mortality, so they can die at any point in their life. And they will die of a certainty once they reach age 100. Each region also has a dynamically rule-abiding government, does all the things that governments typically do, aggregates over federal, state, and local institutions. And each region also has a representative firm. So it rents capital, hires the aforementioned three types of labor, produces a single consumable output good, also pays corporate tax to the government. Finally, each region also has a natural resource and energy sector. Being a little bit more specific about the technology in the model, so following Asimov and Strepo, among others, we model our region-specific representative firm as being Cobb Douglas over the inputs, over capital, and the three types of labor. Each factor has factor-specific productivities that we calibrate to microdata. And every region also has a total factor productivity term, the big phi at the front, that may be boosted by additional capital usage. Every year, we present the representative firm in each region with two technologies, a legacy one that uses its existing capital shares, and an alternate production technology featuring different alphas that are more capital heavy and less labor heavy, and may also feature different productivities based on their calibration. And they will choose whichever technology is more profitable. And there are some theoretical results from my cause recess that kind of shows that firms will typically only tend to choose one of the boundary solutions. In general, they will choose whichever one based off of probability. There are a lot of levers that we can pull in this model specific to transformative AI scenarios. We can shock either the rate of arrival of the alphas, so the rate at which each region gets access to more capital-intensive production technologies. We can change the total factor productivity benefits that's associated with using more capital. This is calibrated baseline, but we believe that modern or the most contemporary AI technologies may have larger TFE benefits than historical notions of technological change, such as things like automation and robotics. And finally, we can also make the adoption of advanced or capital-intense technology skill biased, so it can change the beta T's. Specifically, we generally tend to assume that advanced technologies take away more income share from low-skill workers, this specific to transformative AI and specific LLMs, this may or may not be the case. Our main scenario, what we define as transformative AI, entails capital increasing from roughly a third of input as of today, becoming a majority input factor, so more than 50% by 2050, and more than 60% by the end of the century, by 2100. Here is a quick overview of the factor shares. So these should be considered as the shares of US GDP that accrue to capital, K, and the three types of labor. The key number to read here is that in our base case, we project a small increase in capital use intensivity in the baseline between the current year 2022 and 2050, which is extrapolated from US historicals. While in our transformative AI scenario, TI scenario, K-shares go up to approximately 56% by 2050 and 60% by 2100. And this entails a reduction of labor share equally approximately across the three skill groups. So one more sort of segue before we show the transformative AI results. What does our model say about the global economy in a baseline? I think this is kind of important context to understand the transformative AI results. So driven by demographics and capital deepening, as well as productivity growth in China and India, the share of the US and the Europe of the world economy is projected to decline rather significantly through the century. So declining from roughly about a third of the global economy right now between the US and Western Europe to about a quarter of the global economy by 2100. Almost all of the slack is being picked up by China and India, which by the end of the century, we project to grow to roughly 40% of the global economy. A second and perhaps more important main implication of this model is that the model projects a very long-run decline in the global interest rate. This is for several reasons, primarily due to developed countries experiencing aging, as well as rapid asset accumulation in China, India, and the Middle East, the so-called global savings glut. And these forces will conspire to push down the global real rate of return to roughly 6% as of 2022, to only slightly above 2% by end of the century. So it's going to be there's going to be a lot more capital, rate of return on capital is low. And this, as we'll see momentarily, has some very major implications for the adoption of transformative AI technologies. So turning to TAI, what does that do to the global real rate of return? Well, unsurprisingly, making a technology available that uses much more capital is projected to massively increase the global rate of return, because now countries are kind of fighting over claiming the capital to be able to more productive to use it in the more productive, the more capital intensive production function. So this drives up the interest rate tremendously from to call it the baseline of less than 2.5% by the end of the century to above 12% in the transformative AI scenario. So it's a huge increase. And this is basically all due to allowing firms access to this more capital use intensive production function, which tremendously increases the demand of these firms for capital. Transformative AI is projected to be very good for the US economy. It's gonna massively grow the US. We project roughly, double the US economy compared to the baseline by 2050. And it's gonna quintuple, it's gonna be five times as large compared to the baseline by 2100. And there are a couple of drivers here. Primarily there is a lot of direct TFP boost and global investment effects, the US being a very corporate friendly environment, low taxes, having a very expensive labor force. It is generally the first to adopt the transformative AI technology, and it will be able to soak up global investments and massively grow its economy under the transformative AI scenario. On the other hand, the global GDP effect is considerably more muted. And I think this is pretty interesting. And in fact, if you look at this chart, global GDP doesn't increase at all under transformative AI scenario until around the 2040s and 50s. In fact, it actually dips a little bit, so lower than baseline through most of the 20s and the 30s. And the reason, there are a few reasons for this. One big reason is that not all regions will immediately adopt the frontier technology. Regions will adopt transformative AI if it is profitable, and if a region maybe doesn't have a lot of savings to begin with, has very cheap labor, regions like Sub-Saharan Africa or the Middle East or South America. A lot of them will choose to not immediately adopt technology, the advanced technology, or maybe adopt it all. Additionally, you also have a kind of a substitution type of effect where people in the advanced economies, in the economies that adopt in the US and Europe, and eventually China, they will anticipate this future abundance that is coming from adopting TAI. And we assume that people desire generally to consumption signals, as I think there is quite a lot of empirical evidence. Then they will choose to increase consumption right now and save less. And the problem with that is if you save less today, less cap tomorrow, and that tends to dampen the economic benefits of the TAI technology. And we think this is super interesting. So to put it in other words, the promise of fundamental technological change itself, the fact that there is going to be a breakthrough that's on the horizon, could reduce the benefits of technological change. So because people expect it to happen, it might not happen at all. And I think this has some really interesting consequences, implications for policy. Because of the rapid increase in US GDP versus the rest of the world, which tends to lag behind, now compared to the baseline, recall that the US and Europe see a decline in their relative global economic power. Now there is almost no reduction in their global economic power, either by mid-century or at the end of century. And in fact, through most of the first half of the 21st century, the US share of global GDP generally tends to go up in the transformative AI scenario. Finally, a quick word on the micro side. So these lines we present, these are lifetime welfare of workers by birth cohort. So the way to read this graph is if you look at the x-axis, that's going to be year in which a worker is born. And then the y-axis is how much their welfare increases or decreases under the transformative AI scenario relative to baseline. We are intentionally assuming that this technology is not skill biased, but you can kind of see high skill workers here are still made better off. Why is that? Well, the reason is, the first reason is that high skill workers tend to generally have more assets. They tend to hold less debt. If you hold debt and the interest rate goes up, it tends to not be a good thing. So high skill workers generally benefit from higher interest rates. We also calibrate using actual labor force participation data that high skill workers tend to basically, they care about less leisure. So when their wages go up massively, they will not reduce their labor supply as much as lower middle skill workers. And therefore they will basically get to consume more because their preferences kind of lean them toward working hard and consuming more and experience a larger welfare effect as a consequence. To recap, we develop a global overlapping generations model to simulate the macro impact transformative AI. We find that our assumptions of transformative AI technologies generate huge increases to output in developed countries, in particular the US. However, we do find that global GDP effects are relatively muted, primarily due to the savings as well as capital flight from the developing world. Finally, we find that non-skill bias transformative AI technologies raises welfare of all US workers born after 1940, but the mid and high skill workers see much larger gains. You can see our white paper, it's linked in the slides, for details on additional AI fiscal policy response scenarios. Thank you.